Assalamu alaikum students, I am Shakil Ahmad, your history teacher. Today's topic is the Montague James Fort reforms. We will discuss this topic under three contents or headings. So the first one is background. In November 1917, Lord James Fort, who was the Indian Viceroy, and Lord Montague, who was the Secretary of State to India, they visited India to observe the political situation and conditions. They met with the leaders from the different political parties and held discussions with them. In July 1919, they issued the Montague James Fort report. Their report was called Montfort report as well. So it was comprised of different proposals. So the first one, it was said that the Legislative Council would now be called or known as the Legislative Assembly, and it would comprise of 145 members. Among them, 103 would be elected for 3 years. It means that 103 members would be Indians who would represent their people. Furthermore, separate electorates were being granted to the Muslims and Sikhs community. In this regard, 32 seats were allocated for the Muslims. Next one is the Council of State. The Council of State was being set up, and it was said that it would comprise of 60 members, and among them 33 would be elected, means 33 members would be the Indians. Next one, the Council of Princes was being established with 108 members. So the Council of Princes was actually it had no real powers, and some princes did not even bother to attend what was little more than a talking shop. So basically, there was a least interest of the princes in the Council of Princes because that council was having no real powers. Next one, the Executive Council was also established, and it was comprised of all the nominated members. Almost all the members were British, and only three members in the Executive Council were to be Indian. Next one. In provinces, a system of Daichi was introduced. It meant areas of responsibility were divided into two lists. First one, the reserved subjects, and second one, the transferred subjects. In reserved subjects, more important departments were being kept, like justice, police, revenue, power resources, press and publication. Under the transferred subjects, less important subjects or departments were being kept, like local government, education, public health, public works, and forests. So reserved subjects were controlled by the provincial governor, who was obviously the British, and his executive council, which had between two or more members, and they were being nominated by the governor, British governor himself. Secondly, transfer subjects were kept under the ministers of the legislative assemblies, who were mostly Indians, but actually these councils were elected by the people. This looked as if there was a substantial degree of involvement by the local people, but actually it should not be forgotten that the ministers were chosen from the legislative council by the viceroy himself, so he had the real power. It meant that the ministers were to do whatever the viceroy, the British viceroy, wanted. So simply we can say that the cabinet or the ministers of the legislative councils, they were again powerless. They were not having any decisive power. Furthermore, the British also claimed that they were now extending voting rights to more local Indians, but actually, according to the Montague James Fort reforms, according to the new rules and regulation, still only 2% of the total population could vote. So it was likely to be only 5.5 million people out of total 250 million people could vote. Now we will discuss the reaction of the Indian people parallel to the Montague-Chelmsford reforms. So the major two political parties, the Congress and the Muslim League, were totally disappointed. The Montague-Chelmsford reforms were set out in the Government of India Act of 1919, and the British thought that they would be welcomed with great enthusiasm by the Indians, but it was totally against it. Congress and League had recently come together calling for self-rule, and they were bitterly disappointed by the new structure. At a special session of Congress in August 1918, the reforms were condemned. Only a few Congress leaders, they supported these proposals given by Montague and Lord Chelmsford. It was again true that the local people had more share and say in how they their country was governed. But in fact, the British maintained their own grip on power by ensuring that the Viceroy had the authority to control how India was being governed. Furthermore, because of the separate electorates for the Muslims, other communities, they started demanding the same level of rights for themselves. So, in short, we can say that these reforms or the proposals were disappointing for the Indians, and they didn't support and liked them.